minutes so that I can talk to you all. First of all, if you're a first-time guest here, I just wanted to welcome you. Welcome to Movement Church. We're so excited that you're here with us. Here's what I want you to do. If you haven't already done so, there is a card that came inside of your worship guide today. If you haven't filled that out and you're a first-time guest, make sure you do that. And when the offering baskets come around in a couple minutes, drop it in there. And then at the end of service, visit Connect Central, which is just inside the front door, because we have a gift we want to give you. We're so excited that you're here with us today. Today is going to be amazing. I know God's going to bless us. So thank you for being a part of the service today. Also, if you brought a tithe or you have an offering to give today, go ahead and prepare that now, because we are going to have those baskets coming around during the next worship song. But if you're like me and you don't carry paper money, you have a couple of other options as well. We have online giving, card giving, text giving, all that good stuff, whatever's most convenient for you. And I just want to remind you, the reason why we do this is because Jesus is saving people in this place from week to week. He's changing lives. Relationships are being restored. Mindsets are being renewed. Hearts are being changed. And that is exactly why we do everything that we do. Make life change possible. So thank you for giving. Thank you for making it possible. Also, I just wanted to let you know that we're really excited about a series that we have coming up, and we actually have a little video that we want to show you about that right now.
Spots where it's lacking, God. I pray that we would find our peace. To you. Hey guys, Larry Leibowitz here. You know, when it comes to, this is Mary Leibowitz. She's my niece. When it comes to taking care of a baby, I don't recommend having milk. I recommend putting sour cream, putting it in the microwave, and then give it to the baby. It's delicious. And guess what? I like to give her candy all the time, because candy makes her feel good, and she's up all night for Bobby and Daddy. When I'm with Mary, I let her ride in the front seat with me so she can listen to the hot tunes that I listen to. Right, Mary? Yeah, that's right. She says so, and so does Larry.
Real love is something that travels way beyond the warmth and the romantic excitement that new couples feel. It is caring as much about the happiness and the well-being of your marriage partner as you do about your own. This love makes burdens lighter because you divide them. It makes joys more intense because you share them. And it makes you stronger because you are a team, and together you will achieve things that you could never accomplish on your own. Some see marriage as the final step in one's romantic relationship. A couple begins to date, they fall in love, and then they decide to spend the rest of their lives together, taking that final step, getting married. But marriage isn't the couple's final step in the relationship. Really, it's just the beginning of a brand new journey of life to be lived together. As with every married couple, you've already experienced your share of joys and blessings and even challenges. And today, you both wish to reconfirm and commit to continue to walk through this life together as husband and wife. Family, friends, and guests have been gathered here today to share and celebrate Christy and Fred's recommitment of love and marriage during this time together. Who gives this woman to this man and recommitment?
Thank you. Marriage is the foundation of home life and social order. It's the foundation. Given its origins by God's divine wisdom and goodness, holy matrimony must remain sacred until the very end of time. It was sanctioned and honored by the presence and power of our Lord Jesus Christ at the marriage in Cana of Galilee, which marked the very beginning of his wondrous works. Marriage is of God. It is ordained of heaven. It is the first and holiest institution that we have among men. God himself gave the first bride away. God himself performed the first wedding ceremony. In the Garden of Eden, God himself, our Heavenly Father, blessed and sanctified the very first home. So in Genesis chapter 2, this is what it speaks of. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. Then the Lord said, "It is not good that a man should be alone. I will make a helper fit for him." So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man. And while he slept, he took one of his ribs and closed its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he fashioned into a woman, and he brought her to the man. Then the man said, matter of fact, he's saying, "This is at last bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed." See, marriage and home are built upon the foundation of unselfish love. And here's what the Bible says about that kind of love. You two look ravishing. "If I speak in the tongues of men and angels but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and I have all faith so as to remove mountains but have not love, well, I'm nothing. If I give all I have away and I deliver my body to be burned but have not love, I gain nothing." Here's what love is. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoings, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. As for prophecies, they'll pass away. As for tongues, they'll cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. But when I became a man, I gave up childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. So now faith, hope, and love remain. But the greatest of these is love. So realizing, therefore, the special gift of marriage, will you please show us by turning toward each other? Do you, Fred Owen, in the presence of God and these assembled witnesses, promise to continue to love and to cherish in sickness and in health, in prosperity and in poverty, this woman whose hand you now hold? Do you promise to be to her in all things a true and faithful husband, to cherish her and her only as long as you live?
I do.
And you, Christy Owen, in the presence of God and these assembled witnesses, promise to continue to love and to cherish in sickness and in health, in prosperity and in poverty, this man whose hand you now hold. Do you promise to be to him in all things a true and faithful wife, to cherish him and him alone as long as you live? Fred and Christy have decided to write and to share a few vows together, so you may get the party started.
Okay. 18 years of marriage doesn't have a crystal ball. And if it did, I think there would be a lot less people getting married. You can't see the house fire during the Browns season opener. The flooded kitchen 3 times. Your husband losing his keys in a pack of Sandra in the middle of winter. being so underwater financially, so bad.
Got it.
They almost lose your house. It's times like these, Christy, it would have been easy to say, forget about this crazy cat. But you didn't. Those are just a few excerpts of our 18-year highlight reel. There are definitely more good than bad, though. When my parents passed away, you're my rock. It was one of the emptiest parts of my life. Sorry. You pulled me through. You've been an astounding mother to our 16-year-old son. You picked me up and I'm down. You're my Wonder Woman. One of God's ultimate gifts to me, you. For the file room that's journaling, you had me at hello. You, getting old kind of sucks. But if there's anyone I want to grow old with, it's you. I am looking forward to 18 more years.
Okay. I'm one and only Fred. When I started writing this, I was not sure where to begin. I thought and I prayed and realized every great love story has a beginning. So that's where I will begin. 6,570 days ago, we started as two individuals and became one person. We were so young and we had our whole lives ahead of us. Lord knows we have had our fair share of struggles, late night arguments, which is usually your fault. Despite what life has thrown at us, we have always persevered. Our story has had many, many happy chapters and many sad paragraphs. One of the greatest gifts you gave me was our amazing son. I remember the tears of joy you cried when he was born, how scared we both were to be new parents. We have grown so much together while raising Chase into an amazing young man. My heart is full when I see you two together. With almost 20 years under our belt, you still tell me every day how beautiful I am and how much you love me. So with all that said, I promise you these things. To not keep score, even if I'm totally winning. To share my ice cream. To not leave you behind when the zombie apocalypse happens. I will pick up your shoes out of the middle of the floor because you would rather step over them 50 times than bend down and pick them up. I promise to take care of you and walk with you in this crazy thing we call life until the last breath leaves my body and Jesus calls me home. I will wait for you at heaven's gate so we can be together again. Me and you, you're like peas and carrots. And I can't wait to see what the future has for us. My cup,
on your wedding day, you exchanged rings as symbols of your never-ending circle of love. So at this time, I think it's appropriate to reconfirm the meaning of those rings. Fred, you possess a token of your love and affection to give to your bride as a representation of this holy covenant. In all ages and among all peoples, the ring has been a symbol of that which is measureless. And so it is today, a symbol of your measureless, boundless devotion. It is a circle. It has neither a beginning nor ending. So even to old age and to death and forever, you are to keep these marriage vows upheld. And the sign and the seal of that holy covenant would be this ring. So please place this ring on the wedding finger of your wife and repeat after me. I, Frederick Owen, still take you, Christy Owen.
Still take you, Christy Owen.
To be my wedded wife.
To be my wedded wife.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
For richer or for poorer.
For richer or for poorer.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
To cherish you and only you.
To cherish you and only you.
As long as we both shall live.
As long as we both shall live.
Today I reaffirm my love for you.
Today I reaffirm my love for you.
In the sight of God and family. Christy,
to
possess a token of your love and affection to give to your husband is a seal. Please place it on the wedding finger of your husband and repeat after me. I, Christy Owen.
I, Christy Owen.
Still take you, Frederick Owen.
Still take you, Frederick Owen.
To be my wedded husband.
To be my wedded husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For richer or for poorer.
For richer or for poorer.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
To cherish you and only you.
To cherish you and only you.
As long as we both shall live.
As long as we both shall live.
Today I reaffirm my love for you.
Today I reaffirm my love for you.
In the sight of both God and man.
In the sight of both God and man.
Fred and Christy, today you have renewed the promises and vows you've made to each other on your wedding day. You have symbolized the renewal by reaffirming your marriage vows to each other. Therefore, it is my express pleasure to congratulate you on almost 20 years of marriage and the recommitment of many more together. Fred, you may kiss your bride. Some cupcakes afterwards to celebrate every commitment together.
Yes.
If you're a first-time guest here, welcome to Movement Church. But we kind of like marriage around here. And so, you got to experience that. So hang out with us. I just want to spend a few moments with you together. That was a really awesome illustration. We've been in this series. This is week 3 of a 4-week series called Bad Advice. And basically, most of us live our lives at one point or another as though we have actually subscribed to or taken or are living bad advice. And so week 1 we talked about the bad advice of how to drift from God. It's very easy to do. And week 2 we talked about the bad advice of how to become an addict. And so week 3 we're going to be talking about the bad advice. So I want you to take some really good, some serious notes here of how to commit adultery. Now by show of hands, if you can please just put your hands in the air if you are married. Show me who is married in this room, right? Okay, you're all married, married, married. Okay, put your hands down. Now, is there anyone in here that would say, you know what, I'm not married, but one day I hope to actually get married. Put your hands up in the air. I'm not married, but one day I hope to get married. Now, well, keep your hands up. Keep your hands up. Now, look around. I'll see if you can see anybody that you think is cute. I don't think that's going to work real well. But here's a question that I have for you. How many of you that have gotten married or plan on getting married, by show of hands, would say, you know what? It is on my bucket list, in my 10-year plan, to not only get married, but commit adultery. Anybody? Right? I plan on doing a couple of things. I plan on visiting Paris. I plan on climbing Mount Everest. And I also plan on a very nasty, horrible, painful divorce. Anyone? Anybody? Right? It's exactly right. Because what's interesting is whether you're a Christian or you're not a Christian, 90% of the population of the United States would say, you know what? It's not a good idea to plan on having an affair. It's not a good idea to plan on committing adultery. It's not a good idea to plan these things for our lives because we know that they're not good. Whether you subscribe to Christianity or you don't, either side of the aisle there, you would agree, most of us, 90% of us, would, none of us raised our hand, would say that's a terrible plan, right? And yet, many, 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 many of us have or will commit adultery. Matter of fact, I would say that the Bible, you and I, the majority of the United States would agree with what the Bible has to say about this. Matter of fact, in Exodus chapter 20, verse 14, it says, thou shalt not commit adultery. You should not commit adultery. So we agree with the scriptures, whether you're a Christian or you're not a Christian. That's what it says. In the Hebrew, it says the same thing. In the Greek, it says the same thing. All right? Don't do it. So we would agree. But a recent journal came out here, a journal, Psychology and Christianity, said that upwards of 65 men And 55 women will at some point have an affair. 65% of men, 55% of women will at some point have an affair. Now, two things. One, I want you to understand that you will, if you're new here, hear the kids behind us. We've double-plated that wall, we've triple-plated that wall, we've insulated that wall, but your kids are having so much fun that we can't keep them shut up long enough to have this. And so I just want you to understand that that's a good thing. So just kind of tune them out, tune me in, you do it in your house all the time. All right, that's the way it happens. The second is I don't tell you those stats to induce fear. I don't tell you those stats to make you feel like you're less than an individual, like if you have committed adultery, all right? That's not why I share that. I share that because from the position I sit in and the things that I see as a pastor, this is an absolute epidemic. There have been many situations like that in our church. And you know, as the church at whole, many situations like that, this as regards to a pastor falling into this thing. And so I'm very, very aware of it. I'm very, very, it's a big deal. And so therefore, regardless of whether you agree with it or not agree with it, I want to talk about it today. Because those kind of stats represent a lot of devastation, a lot of hurt, a lot of tears, a lot of pain. Look, I've always said, years now I've said this, that there are few other things that hurt worse than relational pain.
Right.
Anybody ever felt rejected by a significant other? Doesn't that hurt?
Yeah.
I mean, just all the three of us that can be real in here, it hurts. And it hurts bad. And you cry tears and you sob. And so because of that, we're going to address the issue. So, since we agree that nobody stands here and does this, I'm going to walk away from that. Praise God, they have 18 years of marriage. I pray for 25, 35, 45 more years of marriage. But no one, if you're married, stands there. It's a big illustration to show you that no one stands there and expects it to happen. So how does it happen? How does that transpire in our lives? And I would submit to you that I believe that it's baby steps that take us from I do to I did to I don't anymore. And so what are those baby steps? Well, for each person, they're different. But the big idea, for me as a Christian, I've got to lay it out for you. Number one is that you take your eyes off Christ. There's no way that you can love your spouse the way you're supposed to love your spouse and have a good and not have a good relationship with Jesus. Let me say it like this. There's no way you can have a solid relationship with Christ and walk away from your spouse. I'll say it like that. All right. Now, there's always situations where there's abuse. There's always some situations where there are some extremes. But by and large, that's not the case. We take baby step after baby step. So first and foremost, our relationship with Christ begins to wane. Because you're not going to do something sexually with someone you're not married to and then go home and read the book of Proverbs and be close to Jesus. Those two things don't go together. And so we step away from our relationship with Christ. And then, as I explained in the Homewreckers series, which by God's grace, there will be a book one day that I'm in the process of writing that you can, you know, give all of my church people it for free and you just give it to other people. But in that, we talked about this series where you begin to neglect the things that you did at first. And so I'm not spending the time with my spouse that I used to. I'm not giving the attention to my spouse that I used to. I'm not giving the energy to my spouse that I used to. I'm too tired to do it. And therefore, I let myself go. And, you know, hey, it's No Shave November, whether you're a dude or a chick. You know, I know a lot of females in here say, hey, it's not shave leg season time through the winter. And that's bad advice. I just want to tell you that right now. But you just keep going and going and going. And the next thing you know, you meet somebody at your work or at the gym or somewhere, and you begin to form this emotional bond with them. Why? Because they start to listen to you whenever your spouse won't listen to you. And so they ask for a pen, and when you give them the pen, they kind of grab your hand a little too much, and more hand than pen. And then something happens inside of your soul, and you go, oh my gosh, I haven't felt that for 20 years. What's going on in me? I think I am going to shave my legs. I think I am going to go back to the gym. I think I am going to try to get in shape. And before you know it, you have crossed several lines. Maybe you didn't commit the act of adultery because you haven't actually slept with that person, like I can just be honest with you. But you've crossed several lines that have taken you to a place where when you were right here in front of the church and your family and your friends, you never thought that you would be.
Right.
Isn't that right? It's true. It's absolutely true. And so baby step after baby step after baby step gets us to the place where we are very far from our spouse. We are not connected emotionally, not connected spiritually, not connected physically, and we're just there. And the truth is, some of you in this room are experiencing that right now. So, for those of you whose marriages are decent, pretty good, fair, I'm going to give you some bad advice. Three simple steps to allow you to have an affair. Pretty easy stuff. Maybe you're already subscribing to these things. And if you are, hopefully it should be so blatantly obvious to you that this is bad advice that you should probably do something else. The first easy step to commit adultery is this, that you would neglect your marriage. Just neglect it, completely neglect it. Matter of fact, find something else, anything else, and put that in the place of your marriage. Maybe it is your career. Maybe it's even your children, right? That's a good thing. But when we make the good a good thing in our lives the only thing, then we have problems. So put your children there and care more about your children than you do your marriage. Maybe it's your physique. Maybe it's your build. Maybe it's you, you know, going to the gym. Maybe it's your hobby. I don't know what it is, but put something, anything, in place of your marriage. Begin to neglect your marriage. Pretty easy to do once you get started. Most of us do it. As I explained before, let your body go. Break out the sweatpants. Who cares about the muffin top? Just let yourself go. Dudes, don't shave. Don't try to look good. Fart all over the place. Be disgusting. Burp and belch and do what you do, and don't at all try to do what you would have done on the very first day. Don't do that. Do everything else because you already have her and she doesn't listen to you anyway and you hate her guts already anyhow. So completely neglect your marriage. That is baby step number one if you want to commit adultery. Baby step number two is find someone else that you can enjoy common interests with and emotionally bond a bond with. Find someone else. And this usually is surrounded by, I see in workplaces, right? The people that you work with, you guys share a common goal in the job force, what you're supposed to do. And so therefore you see this person at the office every day, or you see this person every time you go into that Circle K, that one Circle K that you drive out of your way because the attendant there, kind of flirts with you just a little bit when you get your coffee. Or it could be the gym. The gym is a great place to find some common interests with someone else so that you can bond with them emotionally. The gym is a great place, right? And so whatever it is, it could be church, it could be AA, it could be anything, right? Church is a great place to find someone else to have an affair with because all of a sudden you can turn it into a spiritual conversation. You say, oh, you know what? I will pray for you in that situation. Oh, that's so terrible what he's doing. He's not listening to you. Are you serious? He didn't give you a, really? She does that to you? Oh, my goodness gracious, you're an amazing man. I think you're amazing. Matter of fact, I'm just going to pray for you. All right, you see where you have these different places and areas of your life where you can form emotional connections and bond with them emotionally all over the place. I want you to find somebody that, quote, understands you, that you feel comfortable with. And by all means, listen to me, do not tell your spouse. Keep it a secret. Keep it an absolute secret. And what's going to happen is you're going to start to form a bond emotionally with that person. And then you're going to start to anticipate your time together. Oh, I know that every single day he takes lunch at 11:45. So I think I'm going to start taking lunch at 11:45 and maybe we'll walk out together. Maybe we'll grab lunch together. I know that she goes to the gym every morning at 5:45. So I think I'm going to start getting motivated and get up and go to the gym at 5:45. And you start making excuses. Oh, it's 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock at night. I know that they're usually on Facebook Messenger right around 10:30 at night. I'm just going to jump on there. And maybe by happenstance, there's going to be some sort of message conversation there. They'll be there, I'll be there. Do you see how this happens? Are you with me? Are you looking at me like a four-eyed monster here? Yeah. This happens all the time, okay? All of a sudden, men, you want to get in shape. Ladies, you want to shave your legs, but not for your spouse, for the other person. So weird how this happens. So crazy, it doesn't make sense, right? The third thing, the final step, if you want to actually have a full-blown affair, is to make excuses and rationalize your actions. Well, you know, if he paid attention to me the way he's supposed to pay attention to me, I wouldn't be seeking attention from this person. But you know, if she actually respected me, if she didn't whine and complain every single time I wanted affection, I wouldn't be seeking affection in this situation. And you tell yourself lie after lie after lie. You know what? This is the biggest lie that we tell ourselves. All else, God wants me to be happy. I'm not happy. God doesn't want that from me. He doesn't make me happy. God wants me to be happy, right? Or you tell yourself this, you know what? It's just some friendly exchange. We text a little bit. We send some, you know, Snapchat photos of each other every once in a while, some messages. Maybe we, you know, but it's never going to actually end in an affair. That's not what's going to happen. It'll never happen. And when it gets closer and closer, because you've stepped more and more from the I do to the I did to the I don't, the next thing you know, you're going, well, maybe, if you're a Christian, this is a good excuse, here's this one. Maybe, since God wants me to be happy and I'm not happy, maybe this is the one and that one isn't. Maybe I was mistaken. Maybe this is where God wants me to go. Maybe this is what God wants me to do. And then you wake up in a situation where you are absolutely far away from what you ever intended to do when you said I do.
Right.
It happens to us so many times. And so if you're new to this church and you just walked in here, I want you to understand something. I am being extremely sarcastic. I know if you're new, you nudge your wife and say, see, I told you everything I told you about moving church is true. They're a cult. They're a swinger church. They're one of those weird churches. I'm being completely sarcastic. It's a joke. The irony of the joke is many of you are living those things as your reality. That's the message series itself. Many of you are doing these things. Many of you, many of us are neglecting our marriage or enjoying common interests with someone else other than our spouse, are making excuses for why we're stepping further and further away from our relationship. And so I want to flip the script very quickly and give you three quick thoughts that will help you do whatever it takes to minimize the risk of adultery, to avoid it. Three quick thoughts. In your worship guide, you should have a place where you can take notes. If you care enough about your marriage, you should probably write something down. And write something down so that your wife doesn't yell at you later for not writing anything down. I know most of us in here think that you and I, we have the perfect marriage, but we don't. Right, just the other day, we were standing in line for homecoming court. My daughter got nominated for homecoming court, and Fran is there, and Emily, and then myself were here. We're getting ready to step on stage, and there was a couple behind us that said that you guys were the model couple. No, we're not. If you've ever been at my house at 7 o'clock in the morning when we're trying to wrangle all the wild stallions out the door in the morning, I promise you, you would not ever say that again. We all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God.
Amen.
We are all jacked up. And so therefore, when we kind of put our cards on the table, we can be honest about it, and maybe we can actually move toward help rather than pretending that we're something we're not.
Right.
So we remove the fig leaf and we say, hey, this is who I am. Jacked up, and Jesus is still good. Three thoughts to do whatever it takes to avoid adultery. Thought number one is this. Do whatever it takes to radically reduce the risks. Do whatever it takes to radically reduce the risk. Here's what I want you to see. In the scriptures, and I hope I'm not boring you, I'm not preaching, I'm teaching you today. One of my favorite topics to teach on. In the scriptures, you're going to see over and over and over and over again, not that verse, but it's coming, but you're going to see over and over and over again this idea of fight sin, fight temptation, fight it. Avoid. Do whatever you have to do. You can stand firm and fight and fight and fight. But I want you to see something, and this is so powerful. Like, if you don't get anything else out of the message, you need to get this. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 18 does not tell us to stand and fight temptation. What it actually tells us to do is to flee. Other translation says run. Run, Forrest, run. Run, run. Flee sexual immorality. Why? Because all other sins a man commits are outside of his body, but not this one.
Right.
This one is different. The Bible says to run, to flee, to get out, to Genesis 39, to do what Joseph did when Potiphar's wife was coming on to him. He got out of the situation and he ran with all his might. You see, we must understand that. We must do that. Matter of fact, Solomon, the wisest man in the world, wrote in Proverbs chapter 5, verse 8. He's writing to his son, and this is what he says, to radically reduce the risks of adultery. He says, keep to a path far from her. Far from her. Don't even go close. Do not go near the door of her house. But what he's basically saying is, hey, look, you need to understand, you've got to stay away. So what you and I think is harmless, is cute, is a funny joke, is this, is that, is taking us way, 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 way closer to destruction than we ever thought. And Solomon tells his son the same thing I'm telling you. Don't even go near it. Flee from it. Practically, this is, hey, if you struggle with pornography, go to triplexchurch.com and get one of those things that go on your computer so that you can have accountability partners, right? We'll give you some ideas about this in just a second, but we don't do that. What we do is we inch ever so close. We don't realize it's never going to happen. It's never going to happen. And before we know it, we're ending up in a full-blown affair way far away from I do to where we end up in I don't anymore. Here's what I want you to understand. We make the line way over here. Adultery's right there. I'm right here. I am connected emotionally. I'm not connected physically, but I am connected emotionally. I'm thinking about this person when I'm at home. I'm wondering when I'm going to be able to see this person again. I'm putting on some extra perfume. I'm doing a few more crunches. I'm here because I'm thinking about that person there, not here. Here's what I want you to understand. The line for adultery is way back here.
Right.
Way, way, way back here. It's not just a physical line that you cross in the bedroom. It's actually emotional. Matter of fact, adultery does not begin in the bedroom or the workplace or the gym. Adultery begins in the eyes and in the mind, listen to me, and in the heart. That's where it starts. In the eyes, in the mind, and in the heart. Matter of fact, this is what Jesus said in Matthew 5:28. Here's what he said. But I tell you, he says, I tell you that anyone who looks, what do you use to look with?
Eyes.
Your eyes. At a woman lustfully, where do you lust? In your mind. Yeah, some of you guys are like, I don't lust with my mind. I lust with my mind. Has already committed adultery with her where?
In his heart.
Where is the line for adultery? It's not way over there. And I'm not ever going to cross it. I can get so close to it, I'm not going to cross it. No. The line for adultery starts in your eyes and in your mind. In your mind. You need to know that. You need to get that. Right? So here's a question for you. If you are married, what do you think your spouse would feel? What do you think they would do if a camera followed you around 24 hours a day, 7 days a week? What would they see? By the way, there are cameras around everywhere. Somebody's watching you, guaranteed. But what would they see? Would they be blessed by your actions or broken? Would they be thankful that they have a spouse that is faithful, that loves God, that loves them, that cherishes them, or would they be fearful? So if you're not married here, you don't get off the hook either.
Right.
You will be married by sheer show of hands one day. Now what if the actions that you are committing right now were videotaped, and one day your future spouse that you say I do to actually got to watch the film?
Right.
One of the deepest regrets I have is that my wife waited for me for marriage, and I did not wait for her. And so I had to stand in front of her that day, and I had to look her in the eyes, knowing that she was pure, and I was defiled. What would they see? Somebody's watching. Somebody's always watching. So you've got to ask yourself, if the line for this sin actually starts back here, do I recognize that? I'm trying to help you. Or do I rationalize my behavior?
Right.
There's no greater pain than relational. No greater pain than relational. What are we going to do? So here's what I want to do. I want to give you some bullet point thoughts to practically help you reduce this risk. If that's point number one, radically do whatever it takes to reduce the risks. What can you do? Here are a couple things. One, keep your relationship with Christ intact and growing. Spiritual bond, spiritual intimacy. Number two, never be alone with the wrong people. on Move It Church's Facebook page. I'm gonna put up there later today. We're gonna put up there later today the 10 commandments that I have for our staff that if you're gonna be a part of Move It Church, you have to adhere to. And it's all surrounding this. And I want you to understand something, okay? Ministry is reactionary. We do ministry, not necessarily cutting edge stuff, but we do ministry because of what has happened. And there have been situations in this church that have happened on our teams that have caused us to put these reactionary things in place, the Ten Commandments. And one of those things is you're never alone with the wrong people. I would submit to you that you should never drive in a car with the opposite sex. You might think I'm crazy. But what is normal isn't necessarily wise.
Right.
Don't drive in a car to a business meeting or anywhere else with the opposite sex. Refuse to do it. It's not going to happen here, I guarantee it. Don't travel with the opposite sex. That's just so, unless it has to be a third party person there. So be careful who you surround yourself with. Don't be having lunch with the opposite sex. Don't do it. What does the Bible say? Flee.
Right.
Get away. Don't think that you're Macho Man Randy Savage and you can fight it and you can beat it and the whole world can't. There's a reason why the Bible tells you to flee. Because you can't. So that's one bullet point. Another one is this. Never, ever, 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 talk bad about your spouse.
No.
I don't know if you understand this, but people see it. Never. I know they're a moron. I know that they have complication on fire. I know that they have caused 3 floods. I think 1 flood was a result of the kitchen catching on fire. But don't post it. Don't post it, don't talk about it, don't do that. Here's another one. I would submit to you that you should surround yourself with people who have strong marriages. Listen to me, young people, old people, everybody. You are who you choose to surround yourself with.
Yep.
Some pastor somewhere said once, you show me your friends and I'll show you your future.
Yes.
If you want a strong marriage, get around people who have a strong marriage. Get around people who you want to be like. Don't surround yourself with every other Tom, Dick, and Harry that does not have a good marriage, that the guy is out cheating and fooling around, that she has no respect for him. Get around people whom you want to become like.
Amen.
Very, very important. And also biblical. Another one. Avoid all inappropriate places and situations. I remember I worked for a marketing company in Cleveland, and every night everybody would want to go to the Winking Lizard, and it just wasn't a good environment to be in. And I'm going to tell you, sometimes I went there because I thought I was strong enough. But thank God nothing happened, but that's foolish. Jeremy today would have done something differently than the Jeremy 15 years ago would have done. I'm not going to go to those places. I'm not going to involve myself in those situations where I could very easily compromise. Avoid all inappropriate situations and places. Here's another one in that regard. Somebody from your past sees you on Facebook, finds you on Facebook, messages you on Facebook, and says, hey, I haven't seen you forever. I'm going to be in town next week. Want to get coffee?
No
way.
No. Holy Spirit, Jesus, delete. No one's home. I'm going to turn on the computer. I'm going to do something I shouldn't do. I'm going to get in front of my phone. Something I shouldn't do. No. XXXchurch.com. Get accountability with somebody. It's free app. Get it. You're supposed to flee this stuff. You're supposed to flee this stuff. Remember what we said last week. Giant. Hey, giant, what do you have that my God cannot provide? What you can get on a screen or on your phone pales into comparison of what you actually have as a gift of God through sexual intimacy. If you're doing it right. Do whatever it takes to reduce the risk of adultery. Second thing to do whatever it takes to radically avoid adultery is to invest passionately in your own marriage. Invest passionately in your own marriage. Can I keep going?
Yeah.
Should we just close it down now and pray?
Yeah.
I mean, come on now. This
come
is
on,
good
dear.
Stuff.
Let's go.
Get with it. Come on. Proverbs chapter 5, verses 8 and 20. Watch this. 18 and 20. This is, again, the wisest man, according to the scriptures, talking to his son and says this. May your kids put your earmuffs on. May your fountain be blessed. I don't know what that is, but I like it. And may you rejoice. I like rejoicing, don't you? It's better than being depressed. May you rejoice in the wife of your youth. Keep going. A loving doe. Now, you deer hunters, you're going to get that. He's equating his wife to a doe. Some of you start talking about deer, it's over. Who cares? A loving doe, a graceful deer. Watch this. I love this part. My favorite one of my favorite verses in the Bible. May her breasts satisfy you always. Yes. May you ever, implying forever, be intoxicated with her love. Amen. Keep going, watch this. Why? My son, 65% of men, 55% of women. Why, my son, be intoxicated with another man's wife? What he is telling his son is, hey, son, there are going to be moments and seasons in your life where you're not going to want to be intoxicated with your wife's presence. But if the grass seems greener on the other side, son, it's time to water your own lawn.
Right, right.
It's time to water your own lawn. So, little quick word study for you because this is free. Get your money's worth. Here you go. The word intoxicated in the Hebrew actually is a Hebrew word that it's phonetically pronounced shagah. Shagah, shagah, shagah. Help me, say it with me. Shagah. Shagah. All right? So to be intoxicated is to be ravished, captivated, and enraptured, and consumed. He says, forever be consumed with your wife. Forever be consumed, son. Intoxicated, enraptured, ravished, and captivated with your wife. Shagah. And that's what he's telling us that we should be doing as well. By God's grace, after 16 years of marriage to the same person, 20 years together, I think she would say too, she's not in this room, but we have more shagah than we ever did before.
Amen.
The shagah gets better and better and better.
Woo.
Yeah. Woo. You need to go home and shagah.
Amen.
Shagah! It's like, but different. Ever be shagah with your wife, with her breasts. That's biblical.
Amen.
That's a good verse. It's a great verse. So that's what he's telling his son to do. So how are some ways we can practically do this very quickly? Three things. Get along with your spouse. Get spiritual with your spouse. And get naked with your spouse. Get alone with your spouse. This is one mistake that I've seen so many couples make, and I am not Dr. Phil, I'm not an expert, okay? I'm just telling you, this is something that we have faithfully practiced for years now, and that is, you must get on a date night. You have to. Your kids must know that there is a night during the week where you and their mom are going to get away, so shut up and don't complain, because the best thing that you can do for your children is to love your spouse.
Amen.
They got to know it's part of it. Our kids have come to the point now where they're not going to complain about it because they know that it's coming. So many couples that I see, they don't have it. They don't make time for it. They don't put it on the schedule. They don't passionately invest in their own marriage because we're too busy. We have too much going on and this and that and everything else, the other excuses. Get alone. Emotionally bond. Spiritually bond. Men, pray for your wives. One of the hardest things to do, pray with them, pray for them. Bond spiritually, bond emotionally, and bond physically. I'm talking about get with it. You understand? I'm talking about don't do the same thing over and over again. Switch it up. Do what you need to do. Keep it interesting. Keep it alive. Do what you did at first.
Amen.
These are some things that you must do if you really want to invest passionately in your marriage, right? So you might say, well, I'm in such a deep place, dark place right now in my marriage. My bucket's empty. And I would say, I understand that. We've been there. But you can't walk out. You've got to make a decision today to begin to fill your bucket, to invest in your marriage, to fill his bucket, to fill her bucket. Do whatever it takes to get you to that place where you are shagahing in a way that you never thought you could. It's important. Very important. The third thing and the final thing, to radically reduce the risk, to do whatever it takes to avoid an affair, is to visualize the potential destruction if you stray. Visualize the potential destruction. Now, I want to show you something here. I have my little basket of goods right here. I'm going to show you this little thing here. Everybody see this okay?
Yes. Yep.
So I want to read this scripture verse and then I want to show you something. I want this to stick with you. That's the third point. Do whatever it takes to visualize the potential destruction if you use strength. If you want to be faithful, if you don't want to end-to-end an affair, begin with the end in mind and think about what could happen if you choose to do it. Watch this. Proverbs chapter 5, verses 3 to 5. Here's what it says. For the lips of an adulteress drip honey. Her speech is smoother than oil. Extra virgin olive oil. Tony, what? But in the end, she is bitter as gall, sharp as a double-edged sword. Her feet go down to death. Her steps lead straight to the grave. Now, just for fun, let's switch up the sex of this. For the lips of an adulteress drip honey. His speech is smoother than oil. But in the end, he is bitter as gall, sharp as a double-edged sword. His feet go down to death. His steps lead straight to the grave. This is where I want you to see. What we tend to do when it comes to these relationships. I've seen it. It's happened time and time again. As we get into a relationship that we shouldn't be in, we have a bond that we shouldn't have formed, we think that it's innocent and we think that it's harmful. And so what happens is they tell us some stuff that really, really, really sounds like it's delicious. I mean, they're laying it on it, you know what I'm saying? You're so beautiful, your eyes. You're so intelligent. I can't believe your husband wouldn't pay attention to me. Goodness gracious. And just laying, their lips are like honey. Mmm. You want to lick all over that. They're as smooth in their speech. She's telling you some things, bro, that make you feel good inside. You ain't felt like that in a long, 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 long time. You know what? I think you're rough. I don't think you're too fat. You know what? I think you're a good man. I think you're a good father. I think you're a great provider. Look at you. Who is she to disrespect you like that? So nice. And you know what? Your butt's not bad either. Laying it on thick. But in the end, what the scripture says, what Solomon is telling his son, is that it's as bitter as gall. You take some good old-fashioned bleach and you mix it in there with all of that goodness. Maybe just a little bit. Words, actions end up being like swords. I have some hacks. Couldn't fit swords in there. Take it off me. And it all ends in the grave. So avoid it. 55% of women, 65% of men will drink the cup. There's some good things in here. Would you agree? I love honey. I love olive oil on everything. Everything. But I'm not into drinking bleach.
Nope.
And I'm not even going to offer this to any of you to drink it, because I know that there's going to be somebody in here who's all doing it! Get it over here! Not going to happen. You're welcome. But let me read that verse again with that as a visual reference for you in terms of what the Word of God is trying to convey. For the lips of an adulteress are honey. Her speech is smoother than oil. But in the end, say the end.
Amen.
She is bitter as gall, sharp as a double-edged sword. Her feet go down to death. Her steps lead straight to the grave. If you want to radically reduce the risks of adultery, you have to visualize the devastation. Here's how you do it. Kids, come here. You know I love you, right?
Yeah.
I want to explain to you why Dad can't live here anymore. Kids, you know Mommy loves you, right?
Yeah.
And Daddy and I have been fighting a lot.
Yeah.
I want you to know why. You know Daddy's best friend? I've been spending a little bit too much time with him. You see, when I get into these seasons and situations where I might think that the grass is greener on the other side, I literally do this. Visualize the potential destruction. And I want you to understand that you should never sacrifice what you want most for what looks good in the moment.
Right.
So let me tell you what happens or what I stand to lose if I get into an adulterous relationship, if I commit adultery. The easy stuff is, of course, I would lose my reputation. Many of you would judge me and say, I knew it. One less preacher. One more fake. Whatever it is. Whatever you'd say. I know that you trust me. But my reputation, my ministry would be gone. That's the easy stuff. The hard stuff is, I'm going to have to stand in front of God one day. And I'm going to have to give an account for what He has entrusted me with and what I did with it. I'm going to have to look at my spouse in the eyes and tell her that I've been unfaithful. She trusted me. She loved me unconditionally. She said, I do. She saved herself for me. I'm going to have to look at my kids. And I'm going to have to say, you know what? I'm embarrassed. I've let you down. I love God. I love your mom. But I let you down. I wanted to be the model that you were to follow when you get married. I know so many of your friends have parents who have been divorced, who are getting divorced, and I know you never thought in a million years that it would be us. Those are the conversations that keep me from putting myself in a situation where I would compromise the integrity of the relationship I have with my wife, my kids, and my God. If you want to reduce the risk of adultery, visualize the devastation, because it looks and feels good going down, but in the end, it will rape everything that you hold dear. Why? For a few moments of selfish pleasure?
Right.
Do you understand? You get what I'm telling you?
Yeah.
Are you picking up what I'm putting down?
Yeah.
It's not worth it.
Right.
I know that there are some of you who will still choose to drink. I don't want to give you these stats. Questions. What percent of people actually marry the forbidden lover? So you have an affair, you get into a relationship with this other person, you leave your family behind. What percentage of those people actually get married? 3%. Only 3%. What percentage of those marriages, that 3%, what percentage of those marriages end in divorce? 75%. That means that you have less than 1% of a chance. Matter of fact, 0.075% of staying in that marriage. Question is why? Because your relationship was built on lies and deceit.
Right.
It's what it was built on. Why in the world do you think it's going to be any different? Less than 1%. So if you choose to drink the cup, just know what's going to happen to you. It's not going to, even statistically, it's not going to happen any other way. Just done. And guess what? It don't have to. It can be avoided.
Amen.
That's good news. So let me give you some more good news, because I know that this has been a heavy topic. Before that, let me just say to you, if you have been one of these people who have gotten in a situation and you've been betrayed and you've been hurt, I want you to know that the heart of God hurts with you.
Yes.
He loves you. We love you. But also, if you're one of the people who has committed an affair, I want you to understand that in Christ there is now no condemnation. That Jesus' love and his grace and his forgiveness is very, very, very real and very, very, very available for you. He loves you.
Yes.
We love you.
Amen.
All of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God.
That's right.
But here is the good news. Though we've been unfaithful, we all have in different areas of our lives, maybe it's not our marriage, but it's somewhere else, God always is faithful. Even when we are unfaithful, God is always faithful.
Right.
Always. Scripture says in 2 Timothy 2:13, if we are faithless, God remains faithful. We've been unfaithful, but the good news is God is always faithful. Whatever our spiritual enemy means to destroy in our lives, God is faithful. Our God can heal it. Our God can fix it. Our God can mend it. Our God can make all things new. What the enemy seeks to destroy, God in his grace, in his power, and his mercy will rebuild. What the heck? There is nothing here for you today. His love, His mercy is available for you in this very moment. The Bible says that God demonstrated His love for us in this. While we were yet sinners, while we were in the act of adultery against God, He sent His Son Jesus to die on the cross for us. That is the best news any of us can ever, ever hear. That there is room at the cross for you. That there is forgiveness. That there is a second chance. That there is hope for a new future. But you must give it over to God. You must give it over to Him now in this moment. So, Father, I pray that today, by the power of Your Spirit, You would do a powerful work in people's hearts. Strengthen us and keep us from giving in to this destruction. I pray for those who have already entered into this season in their lives, that You give them the strength and the courage to give it to You this morning. That what they vowed all those years ago, they would recommit to, just like friend Christy did this morning. Even if they're alone, even if it's silent, God, You hear it. Grace and love and mercy and forgiveness would flood that home, God, that You would put it back together. Father, I pray for those that haven't gotten married yet but hope to one day, the young people in the room. God, that You would protect them, You would bring the very right person for them, that that person would love You, that they would seek You together. Jesus, that You keep them from that temptation. Give them wisdom and good examples to follow. Father, we love You so much. We thank You so much. For even though we are faithless, You remain faithful. Even though we've walked out on You, You have never and will never walk out on us. Even though we've all, at one time or another, completely and rebelliously did our own thing, God, You still pursue us, You still love us, You still want a relationship with us, and You offer that to us today. So God, I just pray for anyone in here that needs a relationship with You. Matter of fact, with your eyes closed, if you need a relationship with Jesus, if you need His forgiveness, if you need His love, if you need His compassion, if you need His new life for you, and you have not given your life fully to Him, I want you to repeat a prayer after me in your own heart, right where you sit. Father, I believe You. I trust You. I understand I'm broken. I understand I'm sinful. I understand that I've been faithless. Right now, God, I feel that You're doing something in my heart. And I ask that You would forgive me of my sin. That You would cleanse me from all unrighteousness. God, that You would take the weight of this pressure of all of my decisions, my bad decisions, off of me. That You would give me hope and You would give me a future. God, You would give me strength to go back home. That You would give me strength to do what I need. To love my spouse, to love my kids, God, that You would give me strength. I can't do this without You. I need You. I confess it. I know it. Right now, by faith, I'm putting my trust in You, and I'm surrendering my life. We love You, Lord. We thank You for Your faithfulness. If I can have everybody stand, we're just going to sing a chorus that all of us knows. Then we'll get you out of here for cake very, very soon. I love you very much. God bless. Thank you.
it's external and relational or financial, or if it's internal or it's spiritual or it's emotional, God, there is nothing that is greater than you. There is no shackle that can hold us back when you have decided to set us free. And Lord Jesus, we thank you that you've decided to set us free. Today I pray over these people. I pray that they would experience the freedom that we just sang about. The freedom that is not a result of making every decision right, because none of us can do it on our own. You've told us that. But it's a result of a gift. It's a gift that you've given freely, but one that came with a high price when you gave your life on the cross for our sins, so that we could spend an eternity with you, God. And we look forward to the day that you make us perfect. But in the meantime, we ask and invite you to continue changing us, making us more like you, and drawing us closer to yourself. Father, we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Why don't you guys...